لم يكن الذين كفروا من أهل الكتاب والمشركين منفكين حتى تأتيهم البينة.
السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اجتنبوا كثيرا من الظن إن بعض الظن إثم ولا تجسسوا ولا يغتب بعضكم بعضا أيحب أحدكم أن يأكل لحم أخيه ميتا فكرهتموه واتقوا الله إن الله تواب رحيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي فالحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين ثم ما بعد السلام عليكم ورحمة الله guys. Now, inshallah, ayah number 12, in which Allah tells us not to make assumptions about people. Ya ayyuhal ladhina amanu ijtanibu kathiran min adh-dhann. Those of you who believe, stay away from, avoid as much as you can or from most kinds of suspicion. Let's talk a little bit about the word ijtanibu first. Ijtinab comes from junb or jamb, which is the side of someone. Ijtinab is used when you avoid something that's right next to you, that's always right next to you, and it takes a lot of effort from you to get away from it. In other words, for us to make assumptions about people is very easy. It's always there. The tendency is always there. And you have to go out of your way to get away from that that tendency that you and I have to judge people or to prejudge people or to assume things about people. So Allah says, اِجْتَنِبُوا كَثِيرًا مِنَ الظَّنِ Stay a lot away from dhan. Meaning go out of your way to make the effort to not pass judgment on people the moment you see them, the moment you interact with them. And don't be quick to judge people. Now it's interesting that Allah in the Quran talks about staying away from false idols, staying away from shirk, staying away from disobedience to Allah, but when he talks about staying away from assumptions, he adds the word kathiran, ishtanibu kathiran, which is remarkable because he's saying this is one thing that you're going to be hit with all the time. And you have to go out of your way, make sure a lot of times that you get away from just passing judgment on people. You know, sometimes people make a mistake and we judge them based on that mistake for their whole life. That's not fair either. People make mistakes and then they recover from that and they become, you can't judge them entirely by one thing. Similarly, people say something and that one thing they say, you judge their entire contributions in life by one thing. And that's actually unfortunately a problem within the Muslim community, within actually the culture of scholarship. Is you have ulama, translators of the Quran, mufassirun, people who wrote explanations of the Quran, who said one thing that you may not agree with, or maybe it was controversial, or maybe even wrong, right? And then as a result, you just dismiss everything they had to do. Their entire contribution in life is completely dismissed. That's not fair. Human beings, we're all human beings, we're not prophets. So when a scholar makes a mistake, even when they make a mistake, you don't have to agree with that mistake, but you don't have to undermine or character assassinate that person either, or assume that they're some evil person whose intent is to misguide and to put humanity into the hellfire, etc., etc. That's just overly dramatic responses, childish almost, responses to people that we disagree with. So we don't make assumptions about the intentions of people. That's the first thing. But then the other meaning of kathiran min al-dhan is also stay away from a lot of different kinds of assumptions. In other words, not every assumption is bad. Some assumptions are good. Some assumptions are good. Inna ba'd al-dhanni ithm. Actually, some kinds of assumption, they lead to sin. Some kinds of assumption lead to sin. So there are some assumptions that are good and some assumptions that are bad. So what are we learning? We're supposed to be giving benefit of the doubt. Those are good assumptions. I don't know you, but I assume you're a good person. I don't know this guy, but I assume he's not a criminal. You see what I'm saying? You have to, in society, you cannot survive until you have good assumptions of people. You have to have good assumptions of people. Unless proven otherwise. Unless proven otherwise, right? So inna ba'd al-dhanni ithm. وَلَا تَجَسَّسُوا And don't spy on each other. Don't spy on each other. Don't try to eavesdrop and kind of hear something about another person's conversation. Don't look over somebody's shoulder to see what they're responding to with the text message. Don't, you know, that's eavesdropping. وَلَا تَجَسَّسُوا Don't like, you know, put an alert out for every time somebody posts something on Facebook or whatever so you can keep track of their movements, you know. Oh, okay, all right. This is wala tajassasu. Then وَلَا يَغْتَبْ بَعْضُكُمْ بَعْضًا. And then don't spill on each other, meaning don't tell on each other, don't, you know, backbite. Backbiting means that you're not lying about someone, you're actually telling the truth about someone, but you found something out about their private life or some flaw that they have and you're sharing it with somebody else. Not a good thing. That's not a good thing, you know. And if you do, like, you know, my own rule for this is, you know, if somebody comes and tells me something crazy, something like horrible, and I want to use that as an example to teach you guys, I'll obviously never name the person. And a lot of times I mix their stories together just so that it's not one person that it's being picked on or whatever, right? But at the end of the day, I only learn about what's going on in the world by people coming and telling me what's going on in the world. But that doesn't mean I have the right to pick on people and kind of insult them and humiliate them and things like that. No. But the same in your personal life, you know, there are things that you know about people that they wouldn't want you to share with others. They just wouldn't, they didn't tell you don't share it, but you know better. You shouldn't share it. And so you don't, and if you're about to start a conversation that begins with, I'm just saying, then you should probably stop. Don't do it. وَلَا يَغْتَبْ بَعْضُكُمْ بَعْضًا. This is, by the way, different from namima. Namima is when you're lying about someone. When you're not even telling the truth about someone. You're spreading rumors about someone. That's far worse. But this is bad enough. This is bad enough. Now, the idea of you telling someone something about your brother or your sister or your friend or somebody, you're spilling your guts about somebody and they don't want you to tell those things, but you're telling them anyway. Are they in a position to defend themselves? No, because they're not there. They're helpless, they're defenseless. This is a disgusting thing before Allah. So disgusting that He describes it as, أَيُحِبُّ أَحَدُكُمْ أَنْ يَأْكُلَ لَحْمَ أَخِيهِ مَيْتًا. Would any of you like to eat the flesh of his brother as he lies there dead? That's the disgusting image Allah gives to give you an idea of how gross it is to Allah that you and I talk about each other behind each other's back. That's how disgusting it is to Allah. Then He says, فَكَرِهْتُمُوهُ. You're disgusted by it. You found that horrid, didn't you? That image itself is something you don't want to put in your head. It makes you want to throw up. Well, that's how disgusted you should be at the idea of telling on someone or talking about someone in not the best light. In not the best light. Sometimes people come and they say, what do you think of this person? And I don't think very highly of them. I've had some business dealings with them or I've had some personal interactions with them and I don't think very highly of them. I say, oh, I don't know enough. I'm not going to say, well, you know what happened with me and them. No. I'll just say, I just don't know enough. Go find out from someone else. Because even that one bad incident I had with them is not enough for me to judge that entire person. It's just not enough. So I'll just play it safe and say, I don't know enough. You know, find out your information from somewhere else. And that's a good policy for you to take. You're safer that way. You're safer that way. And imagine if that's just that small rule alone, not talking behind people's back. Not telling people what they shared with you in private. Or you know some flaws of people, you know, it's probably most importantly husbands and wives, they know each other's flaws. They know each other's mistakes, they know each other's weaknesses. You know, who has a temper problem, who has a patience problem, who has a laziness problem. You know, we know each other's problems. You're supposed to protect your spouse. They have all those flaws, but you're not supposed to talk about any of those flaws to anybody else. هُنَّ لِبَاسٌ لَكُمْ وَأَنْتُمْ لِبَاسٌ لَهُنَّ. They are clothing for you and you're clothing for them. Why a clothing? Because if I have a scar under my clothes, if I have a bug bite under my clothes, if I have a wound under my clothes, if I have some ugliness under my clothes, all of it's covered by my clothes. My wife is my clothing and I am her clothing. In other words, I don't share her flaws with people just like she doesn't share my flaws with people. We know about each other what nobody else knows about each other, you know? So, but that by extension, other relationships in your life too, you don't share what you know about your siblings. You know your siblings' flaws. And you sometimes you get closer with your friends and you start ratting on your parents or your siblings. This is also riba. You just don't do it. You defend your family. Similarly with your friends. Sometimes you were friends with one person and that didn't work out. Now you're friends with another person. And while you're friends with the other person, you know when I used to be friends with that guy? Let me tell you what used to happen. What he used to say. What he used to think. You know, you don't give up, you don't like expose people. This is the idea of وَلَا يَغْتَبْ بَعْضُكُمْ بَعْضًا. And it's absolutely disgusting to Allah. So Allah says, فَاتَّقُوا اللَّهُ وَاعْلَمُوا وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ تَوَّابُ الرَّحِيمُ. وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ تَوَّابُ الرَّحِيمُ. Have taqwa of Allah, be conscious of Allah. Certainly Allah accepts tawbah repeatedly. This time, you know, tawbah is, we think usually tawbah is repentance, is when you do something Allah doesn't want, or you a crime against God. You know, you didn't pray, you know, or you didn't do hajj, or you didn't give zakat, or whatever. And that's a crime against Allah, so you should do tawbah. Now in this ayah, it's tawbah about crimes against people. If you spoke ill of people, you need to do tawbah to Allah. And here's the thing, if you've done something against someone else, Allah might forgive you, but they might not. And they might still come after you on judgment day. So it's good practice in your life to seek the forgiveness of people you may have offended. And this is the month to do two things. One, to seek the forgiveness of those people, and two, to give your forgiveness to people. Small errors or big errors, it's a good time to give forgiveness to people. To let it go. To let bygones be bygones. You know, one of the most amazing things about forgiving other people, on a side note, I mean, mostly the conversation here is about you seeking forgiveness of others. But you forgiving others is actually the most highly rewarded deed that I've studied in the Quran. I don't know of any deed that is rewarded more by Allah, that is worth more to Allah than forgiving someone. You know how I know that? Because there are certain deeds, Allah says when you do those, that Allah will give you gardens, He'll give you Jannah, He'll give you a house, He'll give you, you know, these gifts in Jannah, right? That are indescribable in and of themselves. But when He talks about forgiving someone, فَمَنْ عَفَى وَأَصْلَحَ فَأَجْرُهُ عَلَى اللَّهِ. Whoever pardons somebody out of love and fix their relationship with them, then their compensation is so incredible that it can only be described as their compensation will be something Allah takes care of. Allah didn't even define it. Like, words aren't enough to define what Allah will give people who forgave. So this is the time to do it. You have a couple of days left. Think of the people. Make a list of people you hate. Make a list of people that have made you angry, or have said something mean to you, or hurt your feelings. And systematically, you don't have to call them and say, by the way, I forgive you. But in your heart, forgive them. In your heart, forgive them. And the way to call someone and forgive them is not by saying, by the way, it's okay, you don't have to apologize, we're good. No. You're supposed to call and say, listen, if you feel like there's any, if I'm holding any anger towards you, if I'm mad at you or something, I'm not. You know, I hope I didn't make you angry about anything. I'm asking your forgiveness, just like I'm forgiving you. We're brothers, we're sisters, we're family, we're Muslims. Let it go. It's not worth it. Right? So that's what you're supposed to do. In your heart, you're supposed to have that anyway. You're supposed to do that anyway. And then, of course, you know, spelling it out and saying it is good for you. And it's good for them. Okay, so this is the time to do it, inshallah.